Human civilization, beginning to slow down, but yet still rapidly expanding, now pushing 7.7 billion, and marching out across the earth, relentlessly consuming anything and everything in our path, as we dig and claw at the world in front of us to shape it into and provide the means for creating the things that allow us to live and to live at the current living standards of our modern civilization. A civilization in which, no matter our level of economic struggle compared to the humanity of the past, we still live in an extreme level of ease and comfort. So, as we dredge up the entire earth, constantly seeking for certain specific things that allow us to do everything that we do, it should come as no surprise that by this point, we're starting to push some of those supplies pretty thin. Everything from our fossil energy resources to the critical precious metals like gold and silver that allow us to live in the current electronic age. But there is a list, a very short list, but a list still, of some things that we're actually not running out of. And today we're going to go down that list for you in relative order. Just don't take this as an exact order. So right before we get started, if you like hearing about energy and resources and all this kind of stuff, then subscribe and stick around because we do videos like this all the time. And also, if you enjoy the video when it's over, please don't forget to like it and share it around to anyone else who might as well. And now we'll start off at the bottom of the list with number 5, coal. Now, it has been, for most of us, rightly so, ingrained in our minds that our fossil hydrocarbon energy sources are finite, limited resources, and that is true. However, it is vastly more true for petroleum and natural gas than it is for coal. There's a lot of coal. A lot of coal. There is so much coal. Basically, for a general layout, from the start of our use of it in the beginning of the Industrial Revolution up until now, we've probably used upwards of between 1.5 and 2 trillion tons of coal. However, there is still between 17 and 22 trillion tons still out there. Now, at first glance, if people just look up reserve numbers, it actually doesn't look like it's that much. They basically, for the most part right now, just list how much coal is in areas that are currently being mined and in areas that mining companies own that they intend to mine. They don't honestly list all the coal in a particular nation's territory or a particular state's territory that they think is entirely mineable as a whole. Just how much is considered feasibly recoverable from areas that have, you know, mining plans set up or are already being mined. For example, the U.S. currently lists itself as having around 450 billion recoverable tons of coal. However, that number doesn't really change. Or rather, it'll drop down for a few years, and then every few years it jumps right back up into place as different mining corporations actually conduct thorough surveys on and begin operations in new areas. So those areas' reserves are then actually added to the officially existing list. But if you just give an overlook to the actual amounts in place, then the U.S. has probably near 7 trillion tons of coal actually remaining. And over 3 trillion tons of that is actually up here in Alaska with us. Now, that coal's scattered around a bit. You have 3 trillion tons up under the North Slope here in Alaska. Another trillion tons probably still under Appalachia, despite how much we've mined it out. Another trillion tons up in the West, in Wyoming and Colorado. Got about 2 trillion tons in China along the whole Mongolia-China border. Got another 2 trillion tons in central Russia, another trillion tons in eastern Russia, another trillion tons probably under Australia, another trillion scattered throughout Canada. There's plenty of coal. So, next on the list, moving up to number 4, iron. There's a lot of iron. Literal tons of iron. Billions of tons of iron. Iron is obviously most commonly used as, you know, the main ingredient of steel, basically the primary construction metal that holds up modern civilization and modern infrastructure. Typically is between 90 and 99% iron, might have some minor metals mixed in, and the rest is carbon, which is usually coke extracted from coal. So, ironically enough, our number 5 and our number 4 work together. And iron reserves are scattered all around. You have some big ones that were still nowhere near depleting in northern Michigan and Minnesota. You have similar reserves that, again, nowhere near being depleted in western Russia. Some huge reserves in northeastern China. Unfathomably enormous reserve amounts in Australia. Like with a lot of other things, too, Australia is just the number one source. With Australia, on average, over the last several years, mining between 800 and 900 million tons of iron. Current world iron deposit estimates for known regions is roughly estimated at 800 billion tons. Now, moving on to number 3, and leaving behind our steel-making pair, we move on to talc. A lot of people don't really think about talc that often. Some people don't even actually know that it's a thing. They've never heard of it. It's a really soft, white rock that comes in various different forms of mineralization. It's usually almost always really weak, really brittle, can be crushed and ground into a fine white powder. It's used in a variety of things. It's used in foot powder and some other cosmetic products, along with being used in paper. It's used in the process to make rubber. It's used to make a lot of paint pigments. It's used for all different kinds of stuff. But regardless of its use or whether you've heard of it before, we're not really running out of it. There's plenty of talc out there. To be worth mining it, it has to be occurring in, you know, huge collections. One of the largest of which is at the Trémons mine in southern France. You can see Google images of here. That's the talc being exposed from underneath the mountain. But there's so much talc out there that estimated reserves are listed for some countries, but similarly to coal, those are only being listed for areas that are currently actively being mined. And in most cases, each country with actually listed reserve numbers is estimated to have an actual total of likely more than 5 times the listed number. And for total world reserves, they didn't even bother giving an actual numerical estimate. They just listed as large. A similar trend you're about to see with these next two, which are so abundant that they don't do numbers either. They just list it as vast. Or in the case of number 2 in particular, they just specify very large, as opposed to just large. Number 2, stone, just general stone for general purpose use, not anything specific. This isn't referring to like marble or granite. This is just generalized stone that we crush and grind up and use for road gravel, used for traction in icy weather, but used as a general filler for concrete. It's primarily used for construction material. In just the U.S., over 1 billion tons of just general stone are mined every year, and worldwide, they couldn't even give an estimate. So we just throw large amounts or something like that on there. Since, you know, it's basically everywhere. It is the Earth, or the crust of the Earth, at least. It's so abundant that just on general average right now, it's around $14 or $15 per ton. The idea of an entire literal ton of something only being $15, that should shatter the economic portion of your mind. And in similar fashion, the number 1 spot on our list goes to salt. To cut out some assumptions you might make, the overwhelming majority of our salt that we use, we don't actually extract from the ocean. We literally mine it. There are actually huge underground and near-surface deposits of salt because tons of portions of the Earth used to and have been at the bottom of, you know, previous oceans or seas at any given time. So there's huge portions, huge deposits, entire swaths of land or regions, like especially in the Great Lakes area along the U.S.-Canada border, especially in Ontario. You know, a lot of people from that area might be familiar with the Windsor salt mines, like 1,800 feet down or something. Basically gargantuan just salt caverns that they've extracted. That salt extension just goes out and out underneath the Great Lakes. And so most sources will list for you how much each country or region mines every year, but there's no real reserve statements or resource estimates. It's just listed as vast or very large. Or in some cases, the USGS just listed as inexhaustible at current demand levels. Because again, even if we did mine all the previous deposited salt out of this earth, which we won't, then there is still the ocean that we already do desalinate in some places or use brine evaporation pools. And that takes you into the territory of being essentially limitless. Although depending how rapidly you extracted it, you could cause low salinity ecological issues in immediate vicinity of that particular area. But actually depleting the entire ocean of it? Yeah, no. In all seriousness, yeah, no, we're not running out of salt. Or stone. Or talc. Or iron. Or coal. So, that's it. The entire list. Very short list, as I said, of things that we're actually not running out of. Everything else, though, yeah, supply constraints and issues are either already here or well on the way. But these five things here, don't worry, we're not running out of these. So that's it. Like usual, I hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, please like and subscribe. Don't forget about the bell. You can follow me on Twitter for constant resource and energy updates. If you can, you'd like to, you can support the channel through either PayPal or Patreon. Both those are in the description below, along with the Redbubble merch store with merch items of my better photography pieces. Hope everybody's doing great. I will see everybody around next time.